I want to tell you here about the Swiss torture trio and the real top of the Nazi Templars from Octogon, Switzerland, who were in charge of the ones in control, bearing responsibility for the terrible crimes committed against humanity of World War II, and inside and around the concentration camps, all made possible through Switzerland, who were the real organizers of it all. And they were all Swiss, all three of them. Besides the facts that Hitler got financed in Switzerland by the Swiss General Ulrich Wille von Bismarck, Rudolf Hess studying in Zurich, and Dr. Mengele being an Alemannic ethnic Swiss, being totally protected by the motherland in the Alps, which already discussed in previous films. There were far more Swiss involved in organizing the Nazi crimes. And it's a terrible mistake to just say that Heinrich Himmler, the head of the SS, was the sole top responsible for the concentration camps, who in reality was only responsible for the security, military aspect, with all the horrors his SS butchers inflicted on defenseless people and even on children. And Himmler was also Alemannic, ethnic, Swiss, and even aristocratic of the Nazi Templars of Octogon, which I will prove in a minute. It's always Switzerland and the aristocracy. Number one of the Swiss tormentor Templar trio was the Nazi Reichsminister and SS Obergruppenführer, Leonardo Conti, originally from Switzerland and responsible for the political and medical side of Auschwitz, the concentration camps and the T4 operation. And yes, he was a doctor, supposed to help people by the Hippocratic Oath, and I already made a video about him. Well, there he is, SS Obergruppenführer. Dr. Leonardo Conti. He was born on August 24th, 1900 in Lugano, Switzerland. There he is, from Switzerland. He was the man, one of the three responsible for of the tormentor trio. And number two of the top responsibles from Switzerland of the Swiss Teufelstrio was Professor Ernst Rüdin. Born in St Gallen with the fascist symbol in their coat of arms on April 19th, 1874. And he was responsible for the idea, as being Hitler's mastermind of the genocide and the world's father of eugenics, where eugenics is a closed Nazi-related teaching dividing mankind into two groups, only the ones worth living and the ones better to be wasted. Eugenics always starts with psychiatry, witch hunts, forced sterilizations, and backed up by Nazi politics. And eugenics always ends up with genocides and industrialized mass murder. Just as we can see it progressing in Nazi Switzerland today in 2014, where eugenics is such a fine, typical Swiss concept to begin with. Here we can see it. It was in the newspaper a few days ago. There was October the 8th, 2014. And renitent, and this means asylum seekers, lager, Konzentrationslager, you know, that means a concentration camp. And renitent, that means Swissy is going to tell you who is going, you know, if you don't obey the Swiss, you're going into a concentration camp, and they already built them. Three concentration camps, and the standards for going in there, you know, first are you going to be low. It's the same thing as in the 30s, you know, in Germany. You just go in there, you know, for nothing, really. Only if you don't like your face, or and then the standards and the criteria for, you know, for getting in there, you know, they're getting lower and lower and lower. In the end, it's another genocide coming up, and they're working on it. It's always been a Swiss idea, and nobody is doing anything. Well, anyway, the Swiss are the killers for the aristocracy. You know, they've always been that, you know. The Swiss mercenaries, it's Octagon, it's eight, Switzerland, Octagon. The Pope's Guard, they're the killers for the aristocracy. The Einsatzgruppen, the wave of killers, you know, coming after the German army, killing everybody. It's so typical Swiss. It's not typical German. Three Swissies of the infernal trio giving the orders. One on the medical and political level, one for the idea and conception, and one for the executive. Leonardo Conti, Ernst Rüdin, and Heinrich Himmler. So, Leonardo Conti for the medical and political level, Ernst Rüdin for the idea and conception, Heinrich Himmler for the executive. And before, we already had Swiss Wille, Ulrich Wille in Zurich for the finances, and Swiss Mengele for the execution of the experiments, and all backed up by the motherland. Rüdin studied in Geneva, Lausanne and Zurich between 1893 and 1898, and his name is from the German Rüde, meaning a male dog or a hound, and Rüdin meaning a bitch. Even used as such in the coat of arms of various aristocratic Per A lineages in Switzerland, such as Rüdin von Lausen, as you can see here, with the bitch in it. All showing these werewolf sort of creatures of the Swiss aristocracy in creepy octagon. And here you can see the three things for Isis, Horus and Seth, the holy trinity of the aristocracy and the pharaohs. And as shown here, Ernst Rüdin is a full-blooded member of the aristocracy. And in fact, they all are. These are the ones who have always been doing these horrible things to humanity, and they never stopped doing so. And here it says Ramlinsburg, and Ramlik, that means on heat, you know, as in the Prime Noctis, yeah? Rüdin, the bitches on heat. See my film, Fair Aristocracy, in which I show the nobility's tradition of torture, slavery, murder, prime noctis, child raping, satanic rituals from Egypt, you name it. I mean, look at history. Who has been always doing this throughout history? There's only one answer. The aristocracy. There's only one answer. And here, another Rüdin, or bitch of the aristocracy, so closely related to the Prime Noctis, where they've been injecting their pharaonic genetics into the European peoples. And another one, the three for Isis, Horus and Seth, which is the Horus Matrix. And Rüdin, it stands for the Prime Noctis. And here it says Rüdin, that's the name, and you know, in the Middle Ages, the umlaut, it disappeared, you know, a lot of times, you know, the two dots here. But it's the same name. This is his genealogy. And the aristocracy have always been torturing and doing bad things to humanity and the Europeans. So it's no wonder that this satanic, devilish doctor from Switzerland, from the concentration camps and the eugenics, that he is part of the aristocracy, or rather say the fair aristocracy. And another one you can clearly see this werewolf bitch here with the nose here and the ears. And at the same time, it's an X. And here another Rüdin or Rudin with the fleur-de-lis. And of course, the fleur-de-lis is not only the Nile's lotus, but it's also the three things here. They're tied together here, you see. This is Isis, Horus, and Seth. Well, this one is probably Seth, yeah, Isis and Horus. The Horus matrix, that's the way they wage the wars, you know. Kill the man and take the women. It's so simple, wakey wakey. Dr. Mengele from Auschwitz, or Dr. Death, was Ernst Rüdin's subordinate. And just as Mengele, Rüdin experimented on people doing cryogenics and see how long a person could survive in icy cold water. And of course, forced sterilizations using cryogenics or ice. It's all from Switzerland. Mengele, Ernst Rüdin, the whole idea, the whole thing, you know. Here it says, Ernst Rüdin, Dr. Mengele was Ernst Rüdin's subordinate. He was his chief, you know, he didn't have to take any orders, it was his own free will, you know. It's all over, it's all Swiss, it's a Swiss tormentors trio. Himmler, Rüdin, Conti, and here's Mengele. This is the base of evil, believe me. It's in Wikipedia in English, but there isn't very much. In German there's a lot more. It says he was a Swiss psychiatrist, geneticist, and eugenicist. Rüdin was born in St Gallen, Switzerland. I just showed it to you in 1874. He's the father of racial hygiene. It says he's a Nazi expert. I'll show you the German one now. So here's the German Wikipedia, and this is interesting here. It says for the German Luftwaffe, the Air Force, you know, it's cold up there and sometimes they land into the water. It's minus zero, it's freezing in the air. So he was interested in there's no oxygen. So he did Menschenversuche, that means experiments on human beings, considering Sauerstoffmangel, that means oxygen deprivation. And they're still torturing people here in Switzerland. This is code O2T. And it has been done with the plastic bags, the order of the solar temple. You know, they're so obsessed with this, the Swissies are. So the Swiss Rüdin was highly interested in human experimenting, considering oxygen deprivation, together with Fritz Röder. And this, of course, O2T torture, which is a Swiss speciality. The Swiss Rüdin often came to the concentration camps to collect some human material for his experiments. And he peacefully died on October 22nd, 1952, without ever having any problems with the authorities for his crimes. And he's still highly respected in the motherland in the Alps. Just as many of the Swiss SS as Hauptsturmführer Franz Riedweg and SS Hauptsturmführer Dr. Kurt Brüderlin, still honored by the Evelyn Order, a Swiss Nazi organization specialized in developing the idea of Islamofascism into the Arab world. Well, there's so many of them, I just can't show them all. You know, I showed just a couple of them. So this is another doctor, you see. Well, it's completely laws of silence here. It's the omerta of the biggest mafia in the world, the Swiss Nazi mafia. And, you never get a word out, you know. Well, I did, actually. So. So this is their website, and they came and visited me once. The first time with 5 guys and the second time with 6, and we had to escape. And because I escaped, they put me in prison again. They all work together here, you know. They're all smiling and we're so, we're so neutral, you know. But oh boy, the things going on here. So here it says, Evelyn. This is the Evelyn portrait. The Evelyn order or community. Well, you can look it up yourself, you know. Yeah, there they are. Evelyn. Well, it looks nice, you know, it looks like Celtic, but it isn't. Oh, there he is, Franz Rydwick, a high officer in the SS. Here it says again, you know, he's the most influential Swiss in Nazi Germany. Well, I mean, the other ones were already quite influential, you know. And he was in a special military unit which served Adolf Hitler, personal guard, entrusted with extensive power and authority. Well, I mean, you can see the Swiss, the Germans were just the soldiers, more like. But the head, you know, all the guys are really the mind, the mastermind behind it all. They're Swiss. Yeah, the Swiss was entrusted with organizing the recruitment and political education of Waffen-SS volunteers. You know, just as the Swiss had the Germans volunteer. They are the mastermind behind it all. And there's so many. I mean, I can't even show them all to you. I'm going to read the whole article here. Just punch pause. And they just lived on, you know, and then continued to do their things in Switzerland. But maybe this guy was there as well, you know, when they came and threatened me. I mean, he's related with these, with this other Huber guy, you know, just like gay Edgar Huber of the Evelyn community. I tell you, I've been living hell here, like 17 years. Just Nazi, Swiss Nazi hell. And even the Swiss who, you know, who pretend to be otherwise, well, they're not. They're all a bunch of Nazis, really. There's no left wing, there's nothing. They all lie through their teeth, I tell you. They're all in favor of Nazism, fascism, eugenics, well, you name it. There's not very much in English, you know, but here it says he was Franz Rüdig. He was born in 1907 in Luzern. That's where I filmed the German helmet, remember, in Luzern. That's where the Nazi red line, where they passed by. He was there, I tell you, you know. It says, he knew Joseph Goebbels, he knew Himmler, well, he was Swiss anyway. All of them, he knew them all. Hitler, I mean, he was a doctor. He was even a doctor, they're all doctors and torturing people. Switzerland is the mastermind, they masterminded World War II. And the concentration camps, the murder on Germans, on Jews, on everyone. It's all Swiss. Oh, yeah, it says he was even an SS Obersturmbannführer. That's even higher. It's almost like a general, probably, or something. And he died quiet. He almost got 100 years, you know. 100 years of wasted life, you know, I'd say, you know. 98 years old, and he died peacefully in Munich, just like the other one, just like Ernst Rüdin. He also died in Munich. Oh man. The T4 or Tiergarten 4 human experimenting program and sterilization facility of the Swiss eugenicists Ernst Rüdin and Leonardo Conti actually stands for Templar 4. Well, here he is. This is Leonardo Conti. You can read the whole story. It was in Spiegel, German magazine. So the T4, it actually stands for Templar 4, with 4 of the base of the pyramid and power structure, meaning the common people, as in the relation to the inner circle, six of the Masons, defended by eight for octagon. I explained this in this video. I have it in English too somewhere. And here's the six, which is the inner circle, and like the square and the compass. And they're defended by the eight, octagon, the military wing. And we are number four, like T4. We can be wasted, it doesn't matter, like on the battlefield or as cannon fodder or for human experiments. So this is the base of the pyramid. So this is 4, 8 and 6. Remember that number, you see it a lot. Yes, there are indeed two very different types of fascism. Fascism for the poor, the soldiers, the masses, and fascism for the rich, the nobility, Switzerland and the financial elites. Where Germany mostly represented fascism for the poor, and Switzerland fascism for the rich, the mastermind. The third of the Swiss Teufelstrio is Heinrich Himmler. Here he is, Heinrich Himmler. And this is Amin al-Husseini, the head of Islamofascism and the Hanjar Muslim division. So, Heinrich Himmler, he was the head of the SS. He was born on October 7th, 1900 in Munich, the south of Germany. And both his parents were Alemannic ethnic Swiss. And this also explains it, why the Swiss with François Genoux and Ahmed Huber al-Swissri, the guy from the Avalon thing, how they continue to work on Islamofascism together with the Swiss banks again to finance this guy here and Islamofascism, because this guy is Swiss. It's all from Switzerland. His father, Gebhard Himmler, was born at the Swiss border within the Alemannic area of the ethnic Swiss in the German town of Lindau on May 17, 1865. And his mother, also born at the Swiss border within the Alemannic area of ethnic Swiss, but in Austria, in the town of Bregenz. And her maiden name was Haider, like Jörg Haider of the Austrian Nazi Party. It's just one big family, you know. Only Haider was written with an E instead of an A, but it's all the same, you know. So I show it to you here in German, actually, because in the English Wikipedia doesn't show. So here it says, his father, Gebhard Himmler, he was born in Lindau. I'm going to show you in a moment where that is. And his mother, Anna Maria Haider, was born in Bregenz. So I'll show you now where that is. So here's Lindau in Wikipedia. Here it is, right at the Swiss border. That's where his father is from. Again, Wikipedia. And his mother is from here in Bregenz, in Austria, right at the Swiss border. So here you can see, these are all ethnic Swiss. This is Alemannisch or Alemannic. So here is about Switzerland here. And here you can see Bregenz, well, they write in their different form, you know. So this is where the mother of Himmler got born, in the middle of the ethnic Swiss area. And Lindau, it's about here. And later on, they moved to a place about here, on the Rhine, Landshut. It's about here, I think. So, right in the middle. There's even a big chunk of Italy, a big chunk of Austria here, and even Bavaria. This is why most of those SS and Nazi camp commandants, they all came from, you know, the ones who came from Bavaria. Well, it is all ethnic Swiss, really. It's all Alemannic. Well, they are the ones behind it. So this is where he's from, Mr. Himmler. This is Swiss. Yeah. Yeah. And they're even actually discussing it, you know. So this is July the 30th, 2014. That was this year. And they're talking about the Empire Switzerland. Großmacht Schweiz. I already showed you part of this in my film about Mengele and how he was protected in Switzerland. I showed you some other maps. Maybe you can have a look at it. It's in the links. So even the OECD, well, that's in German. They call it a bit differently in English. They even say that Bavaria here and Baden-Württemberg, of course, they fit much better to Switzerland. I mean, this is why all the all the camp commandants, you know, of the concentration camps, they all, you know, most of them, a lot of them, they came from Bavaria. They are ethnic Swiss, and a huge chunk of Bavaria, it's Alemannic, you see. So this is the new Swiss Empire, you know, with here the Bavaria, and this is Baden-Württemberg, and they're actually talking about it. I talked with two different Swiss Nazis long time ago, and they already told me this like 10 years ago. So they're really working on it. I mean, this fits into what I'm telling you. Well, this explains why almost all the top Nazis, Nazi doctors and camp commandants came from the south of Germany, mostly next to the motherland in the Alps, and they're all related to the aristocracy as well. So here again, this is the Lake Boden, Bodensee. Here's Lindau, his father is from here. He has Bregenz, his mother. And this is all in the middle of the Alemannic tribal area. And as you could see, it still lives. It's just, you know, even in the newspaper today or this year. And here's Waldshut, also at the Swiss border. This is Switzerland here. So this is going to be the Swiss Empire, and they're working on it, guys. So all these hundreds of years, Swissies, you know, they have been murdering the people just, you know, over the borders, like during the 30-year war, but it still stayed like Germany. But now it seems they're going to show their real face, their real ugly face of whom they really are. And you can see here, Günzburg, that was Mengele, was from here. Bregenz, there's Himmler around here. They're all from here. St. Gallen, there's Dr. Ernst Rüdin, he's from here. There's a strategy behind it. You know, and through this, you know, by this is France. It still is France, it's Alsace. And through and this is it's part of Italy here, and through this they could, you know, infect France through this area and take key positions in Paris, because this is France. You know, if you're in politics, you can go from here and you go to Paris. You know, the same thing here in Germany or in Austria, you can take over control in Vienna, or you can take over control in Berlin through this here. If you're organized enough, and they did the same thing in the United States, in the Swiss belt. I already showed you this. So it seems to be, you know, we're heading for a big chaos. And that's why, and they know it, that's why they, all their people, they're taking them home, like in one Swiss empire. And it is a bit bigger than this, actually. Well, this is also Switzerland. Bad things are going to happen. And because these guys are sort of German, You won't find very much in English about this in the English Wikipedia. But here it says the prince was raised, erzogen, by Gebhard Himmler, the father of Heinrich Himmler. And later on, he became the something with the baptism of Heinrich Himmler. And here it says his mother is Prinzessin von und zu Liechtenstein. And his father, Prince Arnold von Bayern, you see? And this is very, very important. So you see the aristocracy got their fingers in it again. It's always Switzerland and the aristocracy. I think this is the father of that princess. So Liechtenstein means the stone of light, as in Illuminati or light bearer, and is basically a part of Switzerland. Or maybe Switzerland is a part of Liechtenstein, who knows? And they're using the Swiss franc, and they're tightly ruled by the Prince of Liechtenstein until this very day, 2014. It's still the same. There, the aristocracy is still, well, they're ruling everywhere, but I mean, you know. Now, why do you think Heinrich Himmler got raised together with the upper aristocracy if he wouldn't have had the blue blood of the pharaohs running through his veins? This is probably why he looks like Emperor Hirohito, another pera of the pharaonic bloodlines and warmonger on the other side of the globe. And Japan has always been dominated by the pharaonic aristocracy of emperors and shoguns for the six inner circle and samurais for the eight military wing with their all pharaoh Bushido devotion. My advice is, don't you ever put anyone else above yourself. I mean, the aristocracy never really mingles with other people, you know, so why would they do with this little nothing Heinrich Himmler? He's one of them. And he looks, this is the same bloodline, you know, the same. They even look alike. They look the same, but that's not all. They have the same look at their face, you know, the same cold radiation, you know, it's the same bloodline. It's all pharaonic, believe me. You know, he looks like a Jap, doesn't he? He's got the V of the Templars here, see? You get the same feeling by looking at Himmler or looking at Hirohito. It's like, it's the same Swiss face, you know, like it, If you knock on it like somebody there, you know, it doesn't even look if there's really somebody there. There's no emotion. And it's so typical Swiss, you know. Octagon rules the world, I tell you. Maybe somebody can make a comparison and put them all together, you know, next to each other. We can have a look. I don't know how to do that. But this is the same lineage. I mean, that's for sure. I mean, you could easily fool the Japs, you know, the Hirohito is dead now. But, you know, like before, like putting this one in the uniform of Mr. Hirohito, and they wouldn't even notice. Because they were not even allowed to look at the bugger anyway, you know. It's the same bloodline. I mean, these are the ones we're looking for. They are all over the world. They're a bunch of parasites, they think there's something more than we. They don't even talk to us, you know, they only mix with each other, like we are some sort of a lower species. And they even look alike, you know. Even if one of them is German, or supposed to be sort of German or Swiss German, and the other one is a Jap. They even look alike, because they are neither a Jap or a German. Now, this is octagon, it's pharaonic, that's why. So, if people believe, you know, it's like some other people, like the Jews, or who are supposed to be everywhere, well, these are the ones, the aristocracy, these are the ones who are everywhere. And this is also Hitler's secret, that through his grandfather, Frankenberger, he was a member of the German nobility and therefore had all the original workers' leaders of the original German National Socialist Workers' Party all murdered in the Night of the Long Knives in 1934 and replaced them with the nobility, turning this Workers' Party by the German people into an elitist party. Yes, I told you, there's fascism by the poor and fascism by the rich, and they're not necessarily friends. Hitler didn't give a damn about Germany or the Germanic race. He despised the Germans, really. And Aryan is just another name for aristocrat. Ari, born from the sun. Or do you think some aristocrat would be running around with a spade over his neck, you know, marching with a shovel? No, not really, eh? Well, this is Nazism or fascism for the poor, and the other picture just before was fascism for the rich, yeah? And if there's any girlies who want to hop along, well, they can do it like this, with this instrument here, like a peasant. And then there are these, the aristocratic Nazis, and you hardly see them bouncing around over a field with a shovel, eh? One of the goals of the aristocracy was to crush communism because of the Tsars and the communists abolishing the church, the Vatican and the nobility. This is why the Swiss Octagon, as Karl Jäger of the Jäger Report, and the nobility formed a wave of Einsatzgruppen like Battalion 322 to murder all the civilians, and they came as a wave after the German army. Yes, 322, as in the dark US order of Skull and Bones, where they speak Swiss German, and like the SS have the Skull and Bones, with SS standing for ISIS, as in Pharaonic Demotic only consonants are written, SS. Here it is, 322, like the murder battalion 322. The three top responsibles of Auschwitz were Swiss Leonardo Conti, Heinrich Himmler and Ernst Rüdin. And the real parasites in the evil Swiss setup were not the Jews, but the nobility, who have a long tradition together with the church to live and parasite on other man's cost. Just as the Swiss, their banks and their tax evasion. It was in fact the nobility, the king and lords, who invented the tax system of feudalism in the first place. And nothing has changed really, only that they're hiding behind the new world order system of all those Mason politicians of the very same nobility, which used to be the old world order of feudalism. It's still the same thing. And even Field Marshal Hermann Göring was nobility, with the official title of Ritter von Eppenstein of the Feldenstein Castle near Nuremberg. And his father was the German Governor General of Southwest Africa, also called the King of Namibia. And it's only the nobility meeting the nobility. So he met Count Erich von Rosen in 1920 in Stockholm, where he saw the swastika in the castle and finally married his sister-in-law, Baroness Karin von Kantzow. Well, nobility always marries nobility, even if it doesn't seem so. So how was this Göring saw on the castle? And this is the castle. And there were more things, more swastikas like here. And this is because the because of the Viking connection, the Haunabu with the pharaohs. And I also showed you in another film that this is pharaonic. So through the pharaohs, the whole nobility took this here. And why a swastika in a castle? Well, I showed you here in this video how the swastika derives from a pyramid, just as the whole aristocratic bunch does. And don't you believe that von Stauffenberg tried to bomb Hitler on July 20th, 1944? No aristocrat would do so. And I also showed a part of this video here in Octagon, the Empire of Darkness, but not the entire bit here. You have to see this one here on the same channel, Hatzefratz. And also Göring's daughter, Edda, who you can see here as a baby, was named after Countess Edda of Castellazio and Bukhari, which was Mussolini's daughter, another aristocrat. And Mussolini had lived in Switzerland for several years and even officially immigrated to Switzerland in 1902, living in Geneva, Lausanne and Bern. Well, they all were in Switzerland, weren't they now? Switzerland is the base of the nobility, where they go skiing, own a chalet or two, hide their money and organize fascism against the Europeans. And of course, Göring, Himmler, Hitler, Goebbels and the rest of these Swiss aristocrats didn't die in 1945. Well, General Eisenhower was a Swiss, remember? The Swiss trio from hell, from the Alps. Ernst Rüdin, Leonardo Conti and Heinrich Himmler were the top responsibles for the concentration camps, human experiments, genocide, torture and mass murder. Swissy always has their dirty little fingers in it. Octagon in the Alps is the base of all evil, where all thugs of the world meet up with filth from the Alps. World War II and the concentration camps were definitely made in Switzerland. Leonardo Conti was a Swiss and born in 1900 in Lugano, Switzerland, and died in 1945 in Nuremberg by his own hand while in captivity by the Allies, awaiting the Nuremberg trials for Nazi war criminals. His nickname was the Swiss Sadist. And he was an Obergruppenführer, which is the equivalent of a general. This Swissy was the Reichsheldleader, responsible for the murder and torture on hundreds of thousands of people, and maybe millions. And medical experiments on humans through the horrendous Nazi T4 program. The experiments by the Swiss sadists included cryogenics on living persons, thus putting alive humans into the freezer like a pack of fish sticks, and watch how they slowly die away. Forced sterilization on all sorts of, by the Nazis defined, subhumans like Russians, Jews and most of all gypsies, which his fellow sadist Swissies did on a large scale until 1996, almost the year 2000, practicing eugenics on a very large scale in Octagon, Switzerland, on perfectly healthy people. Well, there are better articles probably, but most of them are in German by the gypsies themselves or other people. So this is, you know, this is by Swiss Info. So this is not really, they don't say everything, like it was almost in the year 2000 when they stopped doing it. In the very same year of 1923, when the Swiss and Swiss General Ulrich Wille, whom you can see here, started financing Hitler. the Swiss sadist became a member of the SA, or Sturmabteilung, in 1923. There's no doubt for me that he was here in 1923, the Swiss in Switzerland with Hitler, Leonardo Conti. And he had a very low National Socialist Party number, 7,225, and his SS number, 3,982, being one of the very first and co-founder of the anti-Semitic newspaper Kampfbund, meaning fight union. And here we can see the Swiss equivalent of the Kampfbund, the Swiss Nazi newspaper of the Hitler era, their man. This Swiss was a Nazi from the beginning, and one of the most important ones, giving orders to millions and deciding over life and death, affecting millions. Well, this is what the Swissies love to do, and exerts total power. It says SS Obergruppenführer, means he's a general. His lovely mother, Nana Conti, who gave life to the Swiss sadist in Switzerland, was the Reichs midwifery supreme under the Nazi Lebensborn program. Well, it looks like the whole Second World War was a Swiss family business somehow, eh? And I don't know what you think about this picture here, but these two guys with a baby. We can see the same sort of pictures nowadays in the newspapers. The two guys getting married and dressed up in leather with a baby. Doesn't it? The Swiss Templars have got their dirty little fingers in everything. And their Swiss fingerprints all over World War II. And all the other European wars. Rudolf Hess knew this because he was there in Zurich where he studied, and he flew to England to warn the British people and got silenced by Hamilton and the fair aristocracy. How do these Swiss manage to look so innocent? You hardly see them. And look at his face, the left one, so innocent looking. I wonder how it's possible that these Swissies always look so innocent. How do they do it? Octagon of the Templars is the base of all evil, hiding in the Alps, with its caves, snow, lakes, and mountains. Here's another mass murderer from Switzerland, SS Standartenführer Karl Jäger from the Einsatzkommando 3A. There we can see he's Swiss. He was born in Schaffhausen in Switzerland. He was in the SS. He was a colonel. A really evil one. They breed some nice people in Switzerland, don't they now? This Swiss colonel from Schaffhausen, Switzerland, is responsible for the murder of 137,346 people in Lithuania, whom he and his men all personally shot manually or stabbed to death with a bayonet during World War II in Lithuania. It's interesting to see how he joined the Nazis in the same year as Mr. Hitler was financed in Zurich, Switzerland in 1923. So this is in Wikipedia. You can all look it up yourself. And this Swiss personally saw to it that 34,464 children got murdered and shot a lot of them himself. And because he was so proud of his achievement, he kept book of every one of these murders on defenseless civilians and innocent children in the horrifying Jäger report. As the Swiss loved bureaucracy and paperwork, and he wanted to show Hitler and Himmler of his work so he could be praised, be an important man, and get up the ladder. So here's the Swiss report in Wikipedia. It's all in here. Keeping track how many people, how many children he murdered. Charming Swiss, eh? You can read some more about in English about the Swiss Jäger report, which of course went to Switzerland, the motherland. There's too much evidence, you know, that Hitler got finance in Switzerland in 1923. This guy, he joined the Nazis the same year, very same year. Of course this report went to Switzerland. And they had a toast on it, probably. Yes, we Swiss, we are so superior to all the other people and other races. They're still showing it today. Look at what's going on in this country. And for this, the Swiss Karl Jäger, which means the hunter in German, where we can see what he hunted. He carried out the murder of 34,464 children, lined them up in front of a huge grave or pit in the sand, let them suffer in the cold where they were shaking out of fear and cold. 34,464 pairs of children's eyes begging for help, and then punch a few rounds in their skulls. Can you imagine witnessing the brutal murder of 340,464 children? Well, this is the type of people Switzerland produces. And if they get the chance, they all want to do this again. When circumstances set the conditions in place, and when the majority around says that it's okay to do so. This is how the Swissies function. Just as the Swiss mindset is ready to do it again today with immigrants, because the majority agrees to do so. They're just waiting for the big moment. And when in 1959, in his cell, the Swiss Karl Jäger was not so tough anymore, complaining about the prison conditions which he was in, he committed suicide. As this time his own life was concerned, and there was nothing to laugh about anymore. The Swiss are hard and mean on others, but very weak to themselves. Just as they're constantly stressing on immigrants to integrate, whereas they themselves, the Swiss, can't even integrate themselves into Europe. The Swissies feel so sorry for themselves, endlessly complain about nothing, and are extremely ruthless with others. Just as a paranoid dog with its tail constantly in between its legs, or like a pack of hyenas who show the same pattern with the tail in between its hind legs. Also female dominated, and also in a totally ruthless society. Thus leading to Ptolemy's famous words that not lions are dangerous, but hyenas are. Ptolemy was the brother of Cleopatra, of the pharaohs, in the matriarchal and ruthless pharaonic civilization comparable to the base of evil in the Alps. referring to the patriarchal lions coming single, whereas hyenas come in highly organized packs, just as the SS for ISIS and the police do. And the time will come that the Swissies have to explain how they financed Adolf Hitler and the rest. They will all say simultaneously that nobody knew, whereas in fact the opposite is true. The Einsatztruppen manually killed 1 million defenseless people and children, just next to a huge pit in the sand, and nobody knew. Well, that's what the Swissies always say, that they didn't know. So today is August the 1st, it's Templars Day in Switzerland, 2014. They all have their flags out everywhere, like here. You know, you can see the bear, like in Blackwater. Or, you know, the revelations of John. Everywhere flags. And they celebrate the domination over mankind, the conquest of the world, actually. As I already told you, that in 1291, the year of the last crusades, they only 2.5 months later, they founded Switzerland on August the 1st. There's going to be a lot of fireworks, and I think already yesterday. So everywhere I look, there are flags, the simplified Templars flags, like on the Swiss Army knife. Flags everywhere. I would have liked to go out and do some more videotaping, but it's too dangerous. I can't do it because of the murder threats by the police. And we're all a bunch of Nazis here. So if I'm just looking, you know, from the balcony, there's flags everywhere. There's another one. I think this is the mercenary flag of Bern. With these, it looks like the Japanese bonsai flag with, you know, with the sun in the middle. Well, I mean, the Japanese emperors, you know, they're not really Japanese. I mean, they're a bunch of pharaohs as well, you know. So, August the 1st, 2014. And because of this, we thank two world wars, the 30-year war and all of that, all these wars. So that's more than 700 years ago, and this is the reason, this is their base. So I'm sorry for not taping a bit more. I would have liked to do it, but it's far too dangerous. As an immigrant, as a foreigner, they just want to lie things together, as they already did. 17 years of terror, and well, they just lied things together to put an immigrant in prison here. So, but this is not what I wanted to talk about. I wanted to talk about Joseph Mengele, who was hiding in Switzerland before and after the war, and well, it's all Swiss base. It all relates to Switzerland, always and everywhere. All crimes against humanity. Due to the complexity of this video here and all the proofs, I'll show the images first in the beginning, and so it has a faster flow as well. And I'll show you the proofs and all the sites and the information at the end of the video. This year, 2014, Joseph Mengele's official Italian passport under the name of Gregor Helmut, from the town of Termini in Italy, has turned up again in the US in the hands of its actual owner, Craig Gottlieb. And with this pass, he could escape to South America and come back to Europe, visiting relatives, seeing other Nazis from the motherland and base of all evil, Switzerland, like Swiss General Ulrich Wille Jr., who financed Hitler and the Nazis, enjoying fantastic ski holidays in Switzerland and seeing his son in a Swiss elite private school, and he also used Swiss Red Cross passports under various names like Fritz Hollmann, Peter Hochbichler, Dr. Merck, and others. Fantastic! What a great country Switzerland is for Nazis and crimes against humanity. We all know that Joseph Mengele was the camp doctor of the extermination camp of Auschwitz, responsible for the death and torture on 400,000 Jews and many more other peoples, and gruesome experiments on children like punching needles into children's eyes without anesthetic, just to see them suffer. And Mengele has become the equivalent for an inhuman alien sort of monster, period. Mengele, by the way, stood under direct orders of Himmler, the head of the SS, but also of another Swiss compatriot of his, the SS general and Reichsminister Leonardo Conti from Switzerland, also called the Swiss Sadist. See my film about him. And yes, I will prove to you here that Joseph Mengele was a fifth column Swiss sleeper agent of Octagon of pure Swiss ancestry, waiting his time to strike. Let's go and do some serious digging. Mengele was born in 1911 in the ancient town of Günzburg in the south of Germany, and not very far from the Swiss border, where there has been a Roman Empire connection since 77 AD. Officially, Günzburg lies in Bavaria, but its ethnicity is rather Alemannic, just as the Swiss tribal roots, as it lies right at the border of the Alemannic Bundesland of Baden-Württemberg. Plus, the Alemannic attacks in 260 AD and 506 during the Dark Ages, and consequently the murder of 70% of its population by the Swiss mercenaries in the 30-year war from 1618 to 1648, where, without any doubt, those 30% who were spared were of Alemannic descent as well. And 1 year before, in 1617, all Jews were kicked out of Günzburg, where the Jewish name Gansburg, Ginsburg, etc. comes from. Only they didn't have the town anymore. So Dr. Mengele grew up in a town not far from Switzerland, of a fifth column of Swiss sleeper agent, and 100% Alemannic, as in Switzerland. Thus laying the foundations for Mengele's visits in the motherland after the war. All the help from Switzerland, his son Rolf being able to go to school in Switzerland after the war, and for the actual plans of today's Swiss Nazis to bring the ethnic Swiss around the borders home in the Reich, Heim ins Reich. And a very dangerous Swiss Nazi informed me about their plans personally, and I think it's even in the web. Well, here it is. So that would be south of Germany, the east of France, and the north of Italy, who are, by the way, for that very same reason, the richest parts of those countries. Yeah, and there will also be a big chunk of Austria, which is called Vorarlberg, which they want to put into the big Switzerland. The south of Germany is far richer than the rest. The east of France has a much better economy. And the north of Italy is comparably an entirely different country than the south, which the northern Italians even call Africa. And this is because all those ethnic Swiss dominions got financial help after the war through what the Nazis had pillaged in Europe and brought to the base in the Alps. This is the result of what the Germans call das Wirtschaftswunder, only made possible through the murder of all those Jews and the Nazi robbery on Europe. So everywhere where it's blue, like all this, this is Alemannic. It's going all the way to the south, even further down here and further up here. And here's Gunzburg, where Mengele is from, which is Alemannic. It's even in the web today. It falls under the Bundesland of Bavaria, yeah, Bayern, but it's not. Its ethnicity is Alemannic, it's Swiss. This is all Swiss here. Gunzburg, it's Alemannic and it's Swiss. And these are their plans. Well, the Auschwitz warehouse and piles of stolen belongings in the extermination camps gave the name to the Bilderberger, or mountains of pictures, by that Prince of Darkness in my other videos on that. And the name of that place, of those mountains of shoes, glasses, hair, suitcases, clothes and pictures of all those who were exterminated, was called Canada, which has been an insider Nazi joke that not many people outside of Switzerland know and understand. In Canada and the north of the Americas, there are not so many people. And when the Nazi Templars came there, they said in German, Canada, which especially in the southern accent that Mengele spoke is pronounced like Canada, and sounds like the name of the land Canada. And now comes the real joke the Swiss Nazis appreciate so much, that in fact concerning all those mountains of belongings and none of their owners was still there, Canada or Canada. And to my surprise, this great Swiss-German joke could even be found in the internet and Google. If you Google like this here, it pops out. Fantastic, isn't it? And this is the explanation of how that incoherent name, Canada, found its way in Pharaoh's extermination camp. From what I heard from insider sources, it was the Angel of Death himself who came up with the name, and apparently he and the Swiss had numerous laugh outbreaks about it during his fantastic ski holidays in Switzerland after the war. And Auschwitz Angel of Death, his nickname in reality, went skiing in Engelsberg, or Mountain of the Angels, and he slept in Hotel Angel, seeing his son Rolf there. The rest of the family, his wife and mistress. What a splendid time in clean snowy Switzerland, so lovely. For a man being seen ripping a baby out of a pregnant woman's womb and throw it into the ovens alive, because he was so upset it wasn't any twins. Mengele also went visiting his son in Montreux, who attended a Swiss boarding school for the world's elite and Swiss sleeper agent community, who felt the need for a decent education in the motherland, like that Korean dictator and all the others. The Monte Rosa Institute, as in Rosicrucian, or the town of Roses of Khodorkovsky's Rapperswil, with a Reichs Eagle in its logo, together with four crescent moons, a Templar's cross and the slogan In Labora Virtus, which carries the same sense as the entrance of his father's concentration camp, Arbeit macht frei, where it's definitely not the elite doing the work. So this is on a Russian website of the and for the oligarchs, as you can see with the Russian letters here, where most probably Khodorkovsky's children are going to school as well, as he's living in Rapperswil, the town of roses. There's another rose here. So this is for the oligarchs in Switzerland, who of course they're all Swiss sleep agents. They all go to Swiss elite schools. And Mengele's son, Rolf, in 2008, this spoiled brat of the elite, being a lawyer at the time, and knowing perfectly well how, as any elite's lawyer, how to play and twist the words carefully, selected to manipulate another man's mind, asked forgiveness to Israel for his father's works. Well, bad habits die hard in certain circles and super-rich families. I suppose by that time the Mengele son had already required his Swiss passport. Forgiveness and justice are two opposite things, where forgiveness is for errors and justice for deliberately committed crimes. And he who in this case forgives abandons the cause of justice. By the way, why would a convinced Germany-loving Nazi as Mengele put his child in an expensive Swiss boarding school and not in his so-called beloved Germany? Huh. Well, because Mengele belonged to the Swiss sleeper agents who wanted to destroy Germany, only pretending to love the German people and that Aryan fairy tales in order to mobilize the Germans, just as Mr. Putin is doing right now with the Russians. There are hundreds of these type of schools in Switzerland, all with a coat of arms like this. It's all the aristocracy and half an octagon, because the pupils are not ready yet, so they're not entirely octagon yet, but they're working on it in this school, and that's what they mean. The Rosy, you know, like the Rosicrucians. Elite Swiss boarding schools are for that pharaonic world's elite of worldwide Swiss sleeper agents only, so their offspring stays connected with the motherland and base of all evil. And then, of course, go back into the world and ask for forgiveness, because it's better for business, as the Mengele family is an extremely rich family that's already made 1 million Reichsmark annually in 1930, then 250 million D-marks after the war, and now half a billion euros profit a year, producing wagon loaders for farmers all over the world. So these are the top 10 boarding schools. Hey, look, Swiss America Trading pops out automatically. The one you know, Bill Cooper went to bed with, and probably, well, the ones who killed him finally. So, you know, it says a lot of kings, the School of Kings, for $100,000 a year. The second one is also in Switzerland. They're all in Switzerland. All the boarding schools. This one too, it has served children of the European royalty and other famous people. Oh, that's Switzerland, eh? And Mengele's son. I guess in Europe every farmer has at least one trailer of the Mengele multi-million dollar business, just as Mengele's medical experiments in Auschwitz are business and big time money, and one of the reasons for his extended stay in Switzerland after the war, while working with the Swiss chemical plants of Basel, analyzing his wartime files on heredity biology. Did the Mengele son give a few wagon loaders to the Israeli kibbutz farmers together with his apology to make it more real? Well, I guess not, eh? They were just sly, empty lawyers' words in the mainstream media, so nobody will blame the bloodline, being the lineage and Swiss neutrality swindle so important for that spoiled brat lawyer from a Swiss elite school. Nobody should grasp the idea of holding the bloodline responsible. So they won't ever do it again to humanity. But their objectives are others. They are doing it again. And therefore the Mengele son had to make a false trail, so no one will blame and follow the bloodline trail. Old Mengele pin badges are now sold on eBay with three pillars on it for IHS, Isis, Horus and Seth, of the Pharaohs and the Horus Matrix. The name Mengele is Alemannic and not Bavarian, as Günzburg rather is in Baden-Württemberg than Bavaria, at least ethnically seen. So the Bavarians really don't have anything to do in this. The prefix Le in Alemannic is the German diminutive for Lein in German, or Li in Swiss German, as in Mengele, you know, Mengelein. It would be Mengelein in High German. Menge means a lot, together, altogether a small lot, referring to that fifth column of Swiss sleeper agents who are both few and many. Few in quantity, but many in force. Few in the beginning and finally taking over in the end. The very reason for those French and Italian speaking parts inside Switzerland, already the finalized status quo of their Swiss virus. The equal plans to incorporate those European border parts into the virus are now happening inside the US as well. The name Mengele withholds the essence of that sneaky Swiss virus and carries the encoded inhibition, just as Canada, Canada, Bilderberg, or Suisse, Sœur d'Isise, Switzerland, the sisters of Isis. The Jews said to themselves that the Germans would never do any harm to them because they are people of poets, writers, philosophers, and Nobel Prize winners. So far, right. Only one problem. The Swiss aren't. I discovered two main types of the Swiss species. The sly, polite type, appearing as a helpful gentleman, but extremely cold and ruthless to the core. Just as Mengele, who was called the aristocrat. Like a Swiss criminal banker or the Swiss diplomatic corps, who want to bitch us into that neutrality swindle, psyop projection. And then there's the more blunt, mercenary type commonly found on the Swiss countryside. And their Heidi counterparts are plain witches, who fully control their male creation of the horror's matrix and know a hell of a lot more than they tell us, those sisters of Isis. Just as Mengele's second wife, Martha, his mistresses, the Swiss she-males around Hitler, financier Ulrich Wille, etc., etc. They were all in it, a close society under the laws of the Swiss Omerta, smiling through their teeth. And among today's Nazis and Nazis in general, there are the same two types as in Swiss society. The blunt neo-Nazi mercenary type and the sly Swiss gentleman-like and far more dangerous typers of the elitist Burschenschaft, and actually gaining enormous influence under the radar, an extremely dangerous development abiding the laws of the Nazi Omerta, the laws of silence. Anyway, the word Führer sounds like Pharaoh, quite a bit. Suspicious. The slogan of the elite Burschenschaft is Ehre, Freiheit und Vaterland, meaning honor, freedom and fatherland. And well, the aristocracy's elite have never been running around with their arms raised. And even if it says here like German cities and Austria, well, remember that a large part of Germany and Austria, it's Alemannic, and they want to go to Switzerland. It has been documented that Mengele went skiing in Switzerland in 1956, and that on March 4th, 1961, a German journalist had informed the Zurich police of the exact address of the Schwimmbadstrasse 9 in Kloten, near Zurich, where the Angel of Death stayed in an apartment rented by his second wife, Martha. The Swiss police then even followed him, but turned a blind eye, as the Swiss police always had and always will protect Nazis, as they are convinced Nazis themselves. Then on March 5th, the Swiss police contacted the German police for an international arrest warrant, who only responded days later on March 7, saying there was no arrest warrant. Well, the whole world knew that there was an award of $2,375,000 on Mengele's head. But on the other side of the dip, Swiss sleeper agent Gay Edgar Hoover was consequently putting all the files of any Mengele, Bormann and Hitler sightings in a very dark and deep safe to be never seen nor heard of again. It says in German in red that the precision parts, they were made in Switzerland, which is true. And the same is for the German U-boat torpedoes. All the precision parts and the for the ignition and all that, it was Swiss. Well, they're well known for precision stuff, yeah? Except when it's about, like, arresting any Nazis, then there's no precision at all, it seems. And consequently, the Swiss Nazi police successfully stalled time until more than 6 months later, on September 15th, 1961, announcing that the German police finally acknowledged the international arrest warrant for Mengele. And in fact, the Swiss Nazi police in reality don't care at all about any official ways, international laws or universal justice or a legal base. When they want to arrest someone, they'll just do it and lie something together to make it hold, and in tight collaboration with the Swiss Nazi Justice Department. And nothing has changed until this very day concerning the Nazi practices of the Swiss Gestapo. While at the very same time and era, the Swiss rounded up tens of thousands of gypsies, also without any moral scruples or on any legal base. And they took away their children, put them with the rest of the Verdinkinder children slaves, and they never saw their parents again. And the Nazi Swiss sterilized all the gypsy women by force. Now, wait a minute. Wasn't Mengele the head doctor of gypsy affairs as well in Auschwitz, doing forced sterilization experiments on gypsies, Jews and others? And now the Swiss were doing it with Mengele in the area? Well, you all got it. The Swiss Nazi police, who were rounding up tens of thousands of gypsy children at the moment, needed Mengele for his experience with gypsies in the given circumstances and his extended know-how on forced and cheap sterilizations, as only Swiss sleeper agents may multiply, and not the others, and most certainly not in their Nazi utopia in the Alps. So Mengele worked together with the racial hygienics leader of Switzerland, Dr. Alfred Siegfried, of the Swiss eugenics program, and who had even visited the Nazi concentration camps during the war. Well, it says Dr. Siegfried is walking with some gypsy children and going to sterilize them all, instead of on no legal base at all, instead of, you know, arresting Mr. Mengele. So here you can see a picture of Dr. Alfred Siegfried with a Hitler's moustache, with whom Mengele worked together after the war in a eugenics program sterilizing the gypsies. And Mengele collaborated with his old pal, General Ulrich Wille, as well. Ulrich Wille Jr., the financier of Adolf Hitler, a close friend of Rudolf Hess, Himmler and Goebbels, and who had founded after the war the Pro Juventute Youth Authorities to better get hold of the children and randomly arrest any youth and keep them in high security prison without trial for long periods of time, up to many years, while sterilizing them and doing other criminal abuses. They officially call these victims administrativ versorgte, or in English, administratively stashed away. being the official terminology given by the Swiss Nazi authorities, a thing they could have easily done with Mengele, but instead did that with defenseless, mostly underage children in that very same period. The whole world was looking for Mengele. The Swiss has always lied to the whole world in the horrible Nazi utopia in the Alps, while Joseph Mengele spent most of his post-war years in exile in Switzerland, while going on holidays to the US to see Werner von Braun, who also worked in concentration camps using its slave labor, meeting Hitler in Argentina and going to Brazil and Paraguay. After his work with the Swiss sterilizing gypsy children and others, Mengele started working with the huge Basel chemical industry to evaluate the fruits and files of his medical experiments in Auschwitz, making money for the Swiss pharmaceutical industries based upon his field of work in heredity biology and eugenics, which he already started for the SS in 1937 as an assistant under Freiherr Ottmar von Verschür, of the aristocracy, whom you can see here. And this guy here of the aristocracy, he peacefully died in 1969. No problem. The Swiss continued Mengele's work of heredity biology together with Dr. Death, or Walter Basson, of South Africa in Operation Coast to invent a biological hereditary bomb which would kill all black Africans only. And now, having inserted a mutated form of Ebola in Africa that has been genetically transformed by the Swiss and their Mengele legacy, possibly with an inhibited mutant potential to owe to airborne itself, so this new Ebola can spread through the air and all over. The mother of the eugenics Hitler financer, General Ulrich Wille Jr., was Clara Gräfin von Bismarck, a countess of the higher aristocracy, and they even received visits of the German Emperor Wilhelm II, William II, that aristocratic warmonger who started World War I and later on Rudolf Hess came for dinner from 1922 on, at least once a week, in their estate in Horgen, near Rapperswil, where Chodorkovsky lives. The pharaohs of the aristocracy are all over it and wanted the Jews exterminated once and for all. The final solution. Mengele had nothing to fear when he visited his father's funeral in Günzburg in 1959, and I wonder how many dead bodies have been transported on the Mengele wagons. And Ulrich Wille also died in 1959. Well, what a busy year there was for Mengele. So here you can see, there's a very interesting video on the Swiss state's YouTube channel, Bundesarchiv, of the visit of William II, the Emperor of Germany, with a Templar's cross on his breast, an octagon on his head, and he's smiling, making some good business with the Swissies. Look here, and probably here, and the army guys behind it. So this was in 1912, at the end of 1912, and not only 2 years after the World War I broke out. Here they were organizing World War I with the Swiss, no doubt about it. So the German Emperor in Bern, 1912, here sticking his finger in up his nose, he personally visited Ulrich Wille Jr., well, first his father, of course, and who was the Hitler financer. You know, they're all linked, you see. This warmonger, he visited the father of the other warmonger, and they finance Hitler, and the aristocracy is all over it. It's all linked, and it's always linked to Switzerland. Look at this Swissy here, next to the emperor here. I don't think he's laughing because the emperor sticks his finger in his nose. He's just happy because he made some good business. Probably one of those Swiss banksters. See, he's having a brilliant time, eh? Two world wars coming up. Nice. Thank you, Switzerland. And within and around this Swiss conquest over humanity and the entire Earth, all these agitators look so normal, as if another species had some memory implant of how and when behave human, and even cry at times about their own minor sorrows only, of course. Of course in total self-pity, but without any remorse. Like some memory implant holding the information of what a real human being should look like when needed for manipulative charms, and knowing by the imprint what a human being wants to hear, with their shallow creepy smiles like Khodorkovsky, Mengele, Himmler and the rest of the Swiss species trying desperately to look so innocent, neutral and human for the eyes of the real humanity. What are they really? What did the Swiss cold species? Where did the Swiss cold species come from before ancient Egypt and the pharaohs? Mengele died in 1979, Hitler in 1962, Argentina, and Dr. Alfred Siegfried in 1972, all protected by the Templars' worldwide web of Freemasonry and Swiss sleeper agents on all key positions in the world. And some official requests concerning Mengele were made in Swiss Parliament in 1999, replying that all files were sealed until 2009, which has been 5 years now, and nobody has had a look so far. Well, why would you, if you can gossip in your cell phone for most of the goddamn day with all our senses drowned in all their presence, seemingly from another world? While the authorities are arming up and the Swiss Nazi utopia is having a Stasi network for anyone who wants to rat out his neighbor, friend or relative, for which the Swiss Nazi police is paying $8 million a year. Oh yeah. Well, except of course when the tango is called Mengele, then. Well, what is there to say more? So here's some information from 1999. From the Swiss Parliament, the official documents about the Swiss knowing where Mengele was at and that they protected him. They stole time like six months, you know, in 1961. They just protected him, you know, from the whole, his whole time in Switzerland. And, well, this is done by a pro forma leftish guy in the parliament. There aren't any left wing people really in Swiss Parliament. They're just pretending. What we can see here, nothing really happened. Now we are 15 years later, and nothing has happened. So it's all a joke. You know, they're all lying. They're just pretenders. All so-called left wingers in Switzerland, they all have the same right-wing ideas. They're just pretending to the world that they are the same as anywhere else, but it's all homogeneous, you know. It's they're all the same. So here's an article in German. I'll give you some articles in English as well about this guy here, General Ulrich Wille Jr. And in the same family, his father was married with Clara Griffin von Bismarck. It's the high, the German high aristocracy. They had a personal visit in 1912, probably in Hagen, where they also received Rudolf Hess, who came eating like once a week from 1922 on, because he studied in Zurich. See my other videos. And the German emperor, this warmonger, came and visited them. Not even 2 years later, there was the First World War broke out. And it's all connected to this family here and to the Swiss. It's not only this guy here, but he was just chosen to do the connections, you know. And later on, he financed Switzerland Junior here. And just right after the Second World War started. So twice, the First World War, he got a visit by the Emperor, then it started, the Second World War, he visited Switzerland, and the Second World War started. It's all from Switzerland, they always got their dirty little fingers in it, and this family received both warmongers from the First and the Second World War. Well, what do you know? I mean, these are the ones behind it. Wakey wakey. So this is very interesting here. I'll give you some more. So this is page one. I put in the link for you so you can read it yourself. It's in Die Beobachter, a Swiss magazine. But there's nobody doing anything here in this country, I'll tell you. So this is Wikipedia about Ulrich Wille Jr., the guy who met Adolf Hitler. And he had Rudolf Hess, here it says Rudolf Hess, Adolf Hitler. He knew Himmler, Goebbels, the whole lot of them. And he founded the, well, you see, he's a lawyer. They all are lawyers, you know, just like Rolf Mengele, the son of the beast. So he founded Pro Juventute, you know, in 1912. Well, that's the same year the emperor, the German emperor, came in Switzerland. It's all connected. Then they were getting bold and they knew, well, we can do it now. And so they could get a better hold of the children. And when Mengele was there, and they met up, they all the time, they saw each other every day. They continued, you know, tens of thousands of gypsies to sterilize them, even Swiss children, just for nothing, with no reason at all, no legal basis, nothing. There was no judge there in it, or, you know, they just did it. And in the meantime, the real criminal, like Mengele, they let him go. And the same thing is happening today. The Swiss Nazi police and the Nazi Justice Department, to just lie a lot of things together to put an immigrant like me in prison. They've been doing this for 17 long years with me and my family. Here it says, Die Beobachter. That was a very interesting article from 2012. Well, that's exactly 100 years after the visit of the German Emperor, Wilhelm II, that warmonger, you know, that cost the lives of 8 million people. And then another, what was it, 50 million after when the Spanish flu came in the world, and it's all related. So this family, they're really extremely evil. And in Hagen, that's not very far, it's just around the corner from where Khodorkovsky is living. Yeah. Also with this creepy, superficial smile on his face, they all have it. Like Mengele, like Himmler, a sort of a strange, funny Swiss smile. A diplomatic Swiss banker smile. You know, it's not even a Japanese could do this, I tell you. So this is about the Burschenschaften. I already told you this. This is for the elite, the student Nazis of the pharaonic class, the Swiss sleep agents and all that, who don't really want to run around in town with without any hair, like a of a member of the pharaonic army, a soldier of the pharaonic army, as the neo-Nazis of the workers class, who completely misled. I mean, these are the real Nazis, the guys in charge, you know, studying in the elite Swiss boarding schools, you know, and all that, like the Mengele son. And they're extremely dangerous, and they're on the way up at the moment, getting more and more influential. I think I already showed it to you, but maybe not the entire text. Well, here it is. And so this is for the Swiss sleeper agents, because they don't want to get known. They still want to do, like, so they can say, well, I'm just a normal person. Otherwise, they couldn't do the real ravaging work in society anymore, you see. This is about Mengele's passport, found again this year. It says 2014, January, about this guy, of this guy here in America. It should be very, very thoroughly analyzed, the passport, where he got it from, where the other one got it from, and follow back the whole line of owners, of ownership. So it was this year, very important. It's hardly any news about it, so I put in the links for it, even on YouTube. Just punch it in and it will be on YouTube. This is the Swiss connection. There's probably some Swiss stamps on it here. There, Swiss stamps. Or maybe not, they don't even, they wouldn't like to leave any stamp on it, you see. Yeah, this is about Mengele's secret tribe, you know, the Mengele factory, the it's on mail online. I put in the link for you. So just punch pause and you can read that. All these people who helped him, of his family. You know, Swiss elite boarding schools, and nobody said a word, eh? This is about the Mengele business in Wikipedia. So these sort of things they're making all over the world. If I saw them everywhere, in Switzerland, in France, everywhere. It's a very big company, international, very, very rich. More than half a billion profit every year, annually. And well, they were backing up his their man, the angel of death. Mengele, one of them. You know, it's always connected with big, huge money, Switzerland. And it is in the Alemannic part of the south of Germany, not very far from the Swiss border. You know, that Swiss Nazis want to incorporate into a big Switzerland, a Grand Switzerland, yeah? And this is Günzburg, where he's from, you see? Here's Switzerland, here. It's right next to the Swiss border. In Baden-Württemberg, here. Well, it's part, it says Bavaria, but it's, you know, the Alemannic goes all the way to here. It's all Alemannic. This here and this here. Which I showed on the other maps. Yeah, this is the richest part of Germany. Here, all the big cars are here. Stuttgart, there is Ingolstadt for Audi. Stuttgart Porsche, and I think VW, and then it's the richest part. And then this big, huge company. There's probably some more interesting things to find in it, but you just find it yourself. Yeah, Siemens. Also in Günzburg. Giving food from McDonald's. Meat. Well, this is the Nazi lineage of the pharaohs and the Swiss sleep agents. Switzerland always have their dirty little fingers in it. This here is a Templar's cake, being served on Templar's Day in Switzerland on August the 1st, every year. This is in 2014. And, well, we all know Adolf Hitler. He loved cookies and cakes with coffee or tea, as he was a vegetarian.
On some days, it was the only thing he ate. So I wonder how many of these he devoured. And how many of these Mr. Mengele ate during the long extended visits in Switzerland, where he spent most of his time, actually, post-World War time. Anybody fancies a Templar's cake? Or would you rather prefer the pyramid cake as from Switzerland, as I filmed before? Eh?
Well, that's the sting of a Swiss parasite. Sucking on the world. Slowly dying. Still moving his legs. But they are slowly dying. It's finished. They're finished. Your time is up, Swissy. Look, there's his sting. Stinging my leg. Sucking my blood. For 17 years. Why do you do that? You Swiss parasite. You Swiss parasite, you want to sting me, take my blood? Well, look what happens to you, you Swiss parasite. Well, there's a horsefly stung me. You're coming out of the forest, or you Swiss parasite. Look at what's happening to you, you criminal. Look, it's still moving. Look at it. It's the end. Your time is up. Your time is up, Swissy, you crawling parasite. You won't be flying anymore soon. We all know what you're doing. No more Swiss Nazi banks. No more killings. No more Adolf Hitlers. No more Zeb Blatters. No more FIFA, you criminal Nazis. You're gonna crawl. You scum. You won't be flying anymore. That's it.
It looks so nice and clean, but it isn't. I tell you, it isn't.
François Genoux from Switzerland was another great eminence from Octogon, who got introduced to Adolf Hitler in 1932 as being the next generation of Octagon's Nazi bankers. And that's what he did for the rest of his life. And as many high-ranking Nazis did, when their miserable lives didn't make any more sense to him, he committed suicide, just as Himmler, Goebbels, Goering, and the rest of them. So in 1996, he invited some friends and organized a goodbye farewell party, where one of the numerous Swiss companies specialized in departures from earthly life took care of the rest. Yes, in Switzerland, euthanasia is legal for humans who are tired of life, thus attracting numerous euthanasia tourists from all over the world. Just another Swiss business branch. I guess any normal person would be tired of living too, if he had all the terrible things on his conscience which Mr. Genoux inflicted upon the world. Now you can read some more about the fella. This is Octogon. And they get the total protection of the Swiss Nazi Justice Department and the entire Swiss population, I tell you. All his life, he stayed an admirer of Adolf Hitler, and he also was a close friend of the Nazi Amin al-Husseini, who combined Nazism with Islam. And here we can see both his friends of the Swiss great eminence,
Genoux, François Genoux, al-Husseini and Hitler. He knew them both personally. François Genoux from Switzerland ruled and controlled over the Nazi gold after the war, with which he financed numerous terror groups, and he always had the full support of the Swiss people and never had to fear the Swiss judiciary. So, there you go, read some more, just bunch of boars. So this is the Grey Eminence, and now there are others, we don't even know their names. There are thousands of Swissies who do these sort of things. And they are behind the attacks in Russia. And they also did 9/11. The 9/11 scam, you know. The Nazis of Switzerland won the war. And they're still doing it. This is what Himmler wrote. Seiner Eminenz den Großmufti zur Erinnerung in 1943, in memory of the al-Husseini. Believe me, Swiss Octagon is behind all terror attacks, including 9/11 and the recent terror attacks in Volgograd, Russia. Octagon's thousand-year Reich. Now, if the damn thing would be drawn in black, like on a piece of paper, you just draw it in black like around, forget about the red. And then if we take away two diagonals, like in white, and only the black stripes are being left, what do we get? I'm gonna cut it out and show you what's left. So shown a drawn Templar's cross here, if I take away the white diagonals. So here we got a Templar's cross which was drawn with two diagonals gone. So it's a swastika in its original form. We just have to bend the outsides a little bit. There we get the swastika. The Nazis used. So this means the Nazis were in fact Templars, and they came all from Switzerland, who gave all the orders. That's why Hitler didn't attack the hand that fed him. So the Nazis were in fact pharaohs, and the swastika is in fact from a pyramid. Okay. You get the point? I already told you that in the Pharaoh show, but now you can see it in a live show here, yeah. What I mean. So here in 1923 we see Adolf Hitler here in Switzerland. You see the guy with the gun in his pocket next to him? So here's when he got the money, and so he had to take the orders from them further on for the whole war. And that meant you kill them all and we take the bank accounts of everybody. This is why he didn't finish up with the British army in Dunkirk, because the Swiss didn't want this. Because if he would have finished them off in Dunkirk, the British army, then the war would have been over, and then there wouldn't be any goal for Switzerland, eh? The Templars. At the beginning of the war in 1939, all the German tanks at the invasion in Poland had the Swiss cross on their tanks, as you can see it here. Later on they changed it. It was too obvious, you know. Here's another one. It's like the white cross on the Swiss flag as they use it today. Then the Swiss asked, it was too obvious, so they asked, they ordered Mr. Hitler to change it into something else, which I'm going to show you later. Then the Swiss finances ordered Mr. Hitler to change the sign on the tanks into this one here, which they kept for the rest of the war, actually. But it's still a Swiss flag. There's only a black one in the middle, you see. So it's a bit camouflaged, as they camouflaged it all. So after the Poland invasion, they changed it for the rest of the war with the black cross in the middle. It was all Swiss financed and Swiss masterminded by the Swiss Templars, the Knights Templars. So the Iron Cross is in fact a Templar's cross. The big one is the Templar's cross, and the little one there is when you take away two diagonals, and it both comes from a pyramid and from the pharaohs, as I proved to you before.